السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The story of Prophet Ibrahim. In the ancient land of Babylonia, present-day Iraq, a boy named Ibrahim was born to carry forth the message of the prophets of the past. The people continued in their idol-worshipping ways. They worshipped the gods they had created, hand-carved out of stone and wood. It may have been easier for them to worship something they had fashioned, because gods created by their own hands gave them the power to choose from right or wrong. Ibrahim was unlike the other children. He was not prone to falling victim to their idol-worshipping ways. He was a truth seeker, and his creator made him intelligent, as mentioned in Surah Al-Anbiya.
وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُشْدَهُ مِنْ قَبْلُ وَكُنَّا بِهِ عَالِمِينَ.
Allah knew of Ibrahim's potential and trusted him with the mission of prophethood. He sent Ibrahim to help guide the people and teach them about Tawheed. Tawheed is the concept that there is only one creator and ruler of the universe, and that is Allah. Only He is worthy of praise and worship, and He has no equal or partner. Ibrahim was born into an atypical family that not only worshipped idols, but crafted them. He was used to seeing his father sculpt these meticulous idols with peculiar features. One day, he was overcome with curiosity. Ibrahim asked his father about the statues he made. His father replied that they were the statues of gods. This response left a young Ibrahim deeply bothered. He loved his father, yet struggled to understand how people could rationalize praying to idols, stone and wood, which they knew were mere creations of their hands. Ibrahim's father hoped his son would join the priesthood and revere the idols as he grew older. But as Ibrahim grew, his aversion towards idol worship also grew. He frequented temples with his father and was vexed by the sight of numerous idols of various shapes and sizes. Ibrahim pondered how the statues, who were idle and could not eat, drink, or speak, could help people in need. He saw the idols for what they were. He knew his father created them, then sold them to the people, who seconds later would be prostrating to them, asking for all kinds of things.
وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ لِأَبِيهِ آزَرَ أَتَتَّخِذُ أَصْنَامًا آلِهَةً إِنِّي أَرَاكَ وَقَوْمَكَ فِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ.
Discovering Allah Almighty, saddened by the plight of his people, Ibrahim set out for some alone time to process his thoughts. He walked in the dark until he arrived at a cave in a mountain. He rested himself against a wall and stared at the expanse of the sky above.
وكذلك نري إبراهيم ملكوت السماوات والأرض وليكون من الموقنين. فلما جن عليه الليل رأى كوكبا قال هذا ربي فلما أفل قال لا أحب الآفلين فلما رأى القمر بازغا قال هذا ربي فلما أفل قال لئن لم يهدني ربي لأكونن من القوم الضالين فلما رأى الشمس بازغة قال هذا ربي هذا أكبر فلما أفلت قال يا قوم إني بريء مما تشركون.
Prophet Ibrahim then addressed his people, who worshipped these celestial bodies as being divine. He explained to them while the sun, moon, and stars appeared and disappeared from time to time, Allah was always present and never lost sight of His creations.
إني وجهت وجهي للذي فطر السماوات والأرض حنيفا وما أنا من المشركين.
وحاجه قومه قال أتحاجوني في الله وقد هدان ولا أخاف ما تشركون به إلا أن يشاء ربي شيئا وسع ربي كل شيء علما أفلا تتذكرون.
وكيف أخاف ما أشركتم ولا تخافون أنكم أشركتم بالله ما لم ينزل به عليكم سلطانا فأي الفريقين أحق بالأمن إن كنتم تعلمون.
His da'wah towards those inclined to astrological science was clever. He did not just deny. He accepted their view, but then logically deconstructed their beliefs. This presentation style would help any rational mind understand the point he was trying to make.
وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ اللَّيْلُ وَالنَّهَارُ وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ لَا تَسْجُدُوا لِلشَّمْسِ وَلَا لِلْقَمَرِ وَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُمْ وَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُنَّ إِن كُنتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ.
It was now time for Ibrahim to urge the worshippers of statues to see the error of their ways and guide them to the rightful path. He resolved to enlighten his father first as a dutiful son.
إذ قال لأبيه يا أبت لم تعبد ما لا يسمع ولا يبصر ولا يغني عنك شيئا يا أبت إني قد جاءني من العلم ما لم يأتك فاتبعني أهدك صراطا سويا يا أبت لا تعبد الشيطان إن الشيطان كان للرحمن عصيا يا أبت إني أخاف أن يمسك عذاب من الرحمن فتكون للشيطان وليا.
His father became furious at Ibrahim. He anticipated that his son would join the priesthood, but blatantly challenged their gods here. It's a sad reality to face because Ibrahim deeply cared for his father, and his love shows through the verses. He remained dutiful, repeatedly calling out to his father with the affectionate phrase, Ya Abati, O Father. This phrase not only signifies respect and love, but also a close bond. Despite his deep affection, Ibrahim found himself in a difficult position. He had to speak truthfully out of concern for his father's welfare in the hereafter. He worried his father might reject his words and be among those whom Allah would punish.
قال أراغب أنت عن آلهتي يا إبراهيم لئن لم تنتهي لأرجمنك واهجرني مليا قال سلام عليك سأستغفر لك ربي إنه كان بي حفيا.
Ultimately, Ibrahim understood a profound truth. One cannot change another's heart or actions. We can only control our response. In the face of his father's rejection, he chose the path of compassion and faith. He committed to making dua, seeking forgiveness for his father from Allah, whose mercy knows no bound. With a heavy heart, Ibrahim walked away, now disowned, yet carrying a light of hope and unshakable belief within him. He carried on preaching about Allah to his townsfolk. He would not stand by and witness his people fall into Satan's trap by continuing to prostrate to idols that could only bring forth severe punishment from Allah. As expected, the people hastened to defend their beliefs and gods. They again reasoned that they were aware that the idols were lifeless, but they had observed their fathers worshipping them and followed in their footsteps. They justified this was enough proof of their belief in their idols.
قال أفرأيتم ما كنتم تعبدون أنتم وآباؤكم الأقدمون فإنهم عدو لي إلا رب العالمين الذي خلقني فهو يهدين والذي هو يطعمني ويسقين وإذا مرضت فهو يشفين والذي يميتني ثم يحيين والذي أطمع أن يغفر لي خطيئتي والذي أطمع أن يغفر لي خطيئتي يوم الدين.
The people were angered after being told that their forefathers had been wrong. Are you condemning our gods and our forefathers? Their voices, a mix of disbelief and outrage.
قالوا أجئتنا بالحق أم أنت من اللاعبين قال بل ربكم رب السماوات والأرض الذي فطرهن وأنا على ذلكم من الشاهدين وتالله لأكيدن أصنامكم بعد أن تولوا مدبرين
Despite Ibrahim's preaching, the people were stubborn and clung to their idol worship. As he left the town, a resolve strengthened within him. He was not one to concede defeat in the face of steadfast ignorance. He knew that a festival was due to take place in a neighboring town, and no one of his village would refrain from taking part. This was his opportunity to show the townspeople the truth about the idols they fervently worshipped. When Ibrahim was certain that everyone had left town, he stealthily advanced towards the temple, carrying a sharp axe with him to execute his plan. When he entered the temple, he caught sight of the various idols made of wood and stone that were worshipped by the townsfolk. He also noticed that food had been placed before the idols as offerings by the people.
فراغ إلى آلهتهم فقال ألا تأكلون ما لكم لا تنطقون فجعلهم جذاذا إلا كبيرا لهم لعلهم إليه يرجعون
He saved the biggest idol of them all and hung his axe on its shoulder. He then patiently waited the reaction of his townsfolk. Upon their return, the people learned that their temple had been vandalized. When they arrived at the temple, they discovered their revered gods smashed with pieces strewn about. Outraged, they began drawing names of those who could have had a hand in the heinous act.
قالوا من فعل هذا بآلهتنا إنه لمن الظالمين قالوا سمعنا فتى يذكرهم يقال له إبراهيم قالوا فأتوا به على أعين الناس لعلهم يشهدون قالوا أأنت فعلت هذا بآلهتنا يا إبراهيم قال بل فعله كبيرهم هذا فاسألوهم إن كانوا ينطقون.
إبراهيم knew he would be summoned for a trial, but he wasn't afraid. He already knew how to outsmart the villagers to show them they were on the wrong path. Ibrahim also knew that if harm were to befall him, it would have to be with Allah's permission.
تعبدون من دون الله ما لا ينفعكم شيئا ولا يضركم أفل لكم ولما تعبدون من دون الله أفلا تعقلون قالوا حرقوه وانصروا آلهتكم إن كنتم فاعلين.
Thus the whole town sentenced Ibrahim to a public burning at the stake. For days, the townspeople gathered firewood in preparation for the biggest fire they could imagine. It was reported that the sick vowed to donate as much firewood as they could find if they were cured. With anger seething their hearts, they dug a deep pit into which they gathered their firewood. They also set up a catapult that would cast Ibrahim directly into the fire. Soon the pit was set ablaze. The magnitude of the fire was such that the flames reached the sky. The townsfolk gathered to witness the historic event from a safe distance. As planned, Ibrahim was bound and placed on the catapult when the chief priest signaled to cast the infidel into the fire. Ibrahim was unwavering. He needed no one's help other than his Lord's. The smoldering fire suffocated those in the vicinity, did not ignite any fear in him. Allah said, O fire, be coolness and safety upon Ibrahim. As commanded, the flames cooled down for Allah's disciple. The burning pit became a resting place for him. The townspeople watched on, assuming that Ibrahim was being burnt alive by the flames. Ibrahim sat amid the fire and glorified and praised Allah. He had nothing but love for his Lord, who had saved him from his people. The fire raged on for a long time, but the people held on, curious to see what would remain of the one who had destroyed and insulted their gods. When the fire eventually burned out, they were stunned to witness Ibrahim walking out of the pit, untouched by the flames. While the soot from the fire blackened the onlookers' faces, Ibrahim's face remained bright. The people cried out in astonishment. The incident was clear proof to the polytheists that they were in the wrong, but their rage held them back from acknowledging their errors and instead increased their anger towards Ibrahim. At the same time, many began following him, although they kept their faith a secret for fear of harm or even death.
وأرادوا به كيدا فجعلناهم الأخسرين.
Prophet Ibrahim debates King Namrud. The news of Ibrahim's miraculous escape from the fire reached King Namrud. He was greatly displeased as this incident threatened his position as a self-proclaimed god. He was not prepared to lose to an ordinary human like Ibrahim. So he summoned Ibrahim to the palace.
أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِي حَاجَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ في ربه أن آتاه الله الملك إذ قال إبراهيم ربي الذي يحيي ويميت إذ قال إبراهيم ربي الذي يحيي ويميت قال أنا أحيي وأميت قال إبراهيم فإن الله يأتي بالشمس من المشرق فأت بها من المغرب فبهت الذي كفر والله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين.
Prophet Ibrahim continued preaching to his people, imploring them to understand that their gods were false and that Allah was the absolute God. Despite his newfound fame, no matter what he told them, the polytheists were stuck in their ways. All the pain he endured, all the sacrifice, miracles performed and still support among his people remained elusive. His father disowned him, his community threatened him, and years of da'wah fell on deaf ears. His path seemed to be one of profound solitude. Yet his reliance on Allah never wavered and was sufficient for him. In time, amidst the sea of dismissal, two souls emerged, drawn to the truth in his message: Sarah, who would become his cherished wife and the pillar of support, and Lot, his nephew, who was destined to become a prophet himself. With no one heeding his call, Ibrahim decided to preach his religion elsewhere for the sake of his Lord.
فآمن له لوط وقال إني مهاجر إلى ربي إنه هو العزيز الحكيم.
He left his son with Sarah and Prophet Lot. The trio traveled to a city named Ur, then to Haran, and then to Palestine. After preaching in Palestine, they traveled to Egypt. Religious texts reveal that Ibrahim's wife Sarah was infertile for many years. As they continued their life of preaching, Sarah grappled with a deep sense of loneliness, stemming partly from her inability to bear a child. Prophet Ibrahim also began to worry in his old age that there would be no one to carry forth his legacy. So unselfishly, Sarah offered her girl servant Hajar to her husband in marriage. Before long, Hajar gave birth to Ismail, who went on to serve as a prophet of Allah. Ismail is considered the father of the Arab nations, and all are his descendants. Abu Huraira concluded the hadith by telling his listeners that Hajar was their mother, O Bani Ma'is-Sama, that is, the Arabs. Ismail is not the only child that Allah blessed Ibrahim with. One day, when Ibrahim and Sarah were very old and white-haired, they had three visitors. As was customary for Arabs at the time, Ibrahim invited the three men for a meal. Who are they? Sarah asked her husband. I don't know any of them, he answered. What food have we got? Half a sheep, she replied. Half a sheep? Slaughter a fat calf for them. They are strangers and guests, he ordered. So the servant prepared a fat roasted calf for the guests. Ibrahim invited the guests to help themselves with the meal, but before long he observed that their hands did not reach for the food. He became fearful and thought that the visitors had arrived to harm them.
وَلَقَدْ جَاءَتْ رُسُلُنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ بِالْبُشْرَى قَالُوا سَلَامًا قَالَ سَلَامٌ فَمَا لَبِثَ أَنْ جَاءَ بِعِجْلٍ حَنِيذٍ فَلَمَّا رَأَى أيديهم لا تصل إليه نكرهم وأوجس منهم خيفة قالوا لا تخف إنا أرسلنا إلى قوم لوط وامرأته قائمة فضحكت فبشرناها بإسحاق ومن وراء إسحاق يعقوب قالت يا ويلتا أألد وأنا عجوز وهذا بعلي شيخا إن هذا لشيء عجيب قالوا أتعجبين من أمر الله رحمة الله وبركاته عليكم أهل البيت إنه حميد مجيد.
The story of Prophet Ibrahim extends through the lives of his sons, Prophets Ismail and Isaac. As we delve deeper into their stories, we uncover the roots of many practices central to the Islamic faith today. These narratives offer rich historical insights and shed light on the significance of pilgrimage and the celebration of Eid. Prophet Ibrahim asks Allah about resurrection. Ibrahim spent his days worshiping Allah and calling people to his religion. He knew that his return to his Lord was not far off. He was curious to learn how Allah brought back the dead in the afterlife. He asked Allah about resurrection, not out of doubt, but out of curiosity.
وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى قَالَ أَوَلَمْ تُؤْمِنْ قَالَ بَلَى وَلَكِنْ لِيَطْمَئِنَّ قَلْبِي قَالَ فَخُذْ أَرْبَعَةً مِنَ الطَّيْرِ فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ ثُمَّ اجْعَلْ عَلَى كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا ثم اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا ثم ادعهن يأتينك سعيا واعلم أن الله عزيز حكيم.
So Ibrahim did as he was told, and miraculously the different parts of the birds that were placed on the hilltops united, and as revealed by Allah, the birds came flying to Ibrahim. Hence Ibrahim was fortunate to observe how Allah gave life after death. He was among the most successful prophets and blessed with many titles like Abu al-Anbiya, meaning father of the prophets, as he was the father of two sons, Prophet Ishaq and Prophet Ismail. Many generations later, through the lineage of Ismail, a boy was born in the desert valley of Arabia, and his name was Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to honor his great grandfather, named his son Ibrahim. In a hadith, he says, "A boy was born to me tonight, and I named him after my father, Ibrahim." Prophet Isaac's direct lineage includes Yaqub and Yusuf. His distant descendants include many other great prophets such as Musa, Harun, Isa, Zakaria, Yahya, Sulaiman, and Dawood. Hence, he is also referred to as the father of nations.
ما كان إبراهيم يهوديا ولا نصرانيا ولكن كان حنيفا مسلما وما كان من المشركين.
Here, in this verse, it refers to Ibrahim as Hanif, which is as a designation for being pure or a true monotheist, someone who renunciates all other deities and only believes in the oneness of Allah. What is most inspiring in the story of Prophet Ibrahim is the way he endured a very lonely life for a long period of time and never lost faith. This is among the most beloved people of Allah, and he was tested severely on several occasions. But the bigger the test, the bigger the reward. One of his biggest tests was to give his firstborn son, the only son at the time, as a sacrifice to Allah. It was a test, but Allah rewarded him with a huge lamb to be sacrificed instead of his son Ismail. This story will be seen in detail in the story of the Prophet Ismail in another episode, inshallah. Prophet Ibrahim went from being alone with no kids, threatened and banished, to becoming the father of all nations, beloved and honored for all time. And he only ever relied on Allah and submitted himself fully. Allah says about him,
وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ دِينًا مِّمَّنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ وَاتَّبَعَ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا.
إن إبراهيم كان أمة قانتا لله حنيفا ولم يك من المشركين شاكرا لأنعمه اجتباه وهداه إلى صراط مستقيم وآتيناه في الدنيا حسنة وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين ثم أوحينا إليك أن اتبع ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين.